Now I am honored to introduce Professor Dr. Muhammad Abdul Latif for the next presentation titled Opioid-Free Anesthesia, a set menu or a la carte. Professor Dr. Muhammad, the Professor of Anesthesia Intensive Care, Surgical Intensive Care Faculty of Medicine, Cairo University, member of the Associate Editorial Board of the British Journal of Anesthesia, former editor of the Egyptian Journal of Anesthesia. Let us enjoy this presentation. Thank you.
This is the lecture outline. I'll start by telling you, in my view, what were the driving forces to the concept of opioid-free anesthesia, the potential active ingredients or medications, recipe and administration, relevant publications, and we'll end by an evidence-based answer to the question of this lecture, whether it is really a set menu, opioid-free anesthesia, or a la carte. Laurent talked about post-operative issues. I'll talk about intraoperative issues, mostly in patients vulnerable to respiratory depression, morbidly obese or respiratory crippled, undergoing some sort of surgery. So it is mainly intraoperative, anesthesia. In my view, the driving forces for the concept of opioid-free anesthesia, which was developed by Jan Mulier in Belgium, pharmacological developments over the years, the concept of laparoscopic surgery, which is expanding all abdominal surgery, most of the abdominal surgeries are done laparoscopically, which is logically less painful. Bariatric surgery, booming, obesity is increasing. Everybody lost hope in doing diet and is now going to very aggressive surgery. And the evolving concept of enhanced recovery after anesthesia. These are, in my view, the driving forces for the concept of opioid-free anesthesia. Let us start by the pharmacological developments over time. The objective of pharmacological developments was to get rid or to minimize hypoventilation, especially in obese patients with obstructive sleep apnea, to minimize hypoventilation at the central level and at the peripheral level. I mean the opioids and the neuromuscular. For the sake of time, I will discuss only the central component of respiratory drive. The early days, we started by no menu. It was one agent in Mass General Hospital, ether. I spent all my residency myself, Hoda Saad, Hoda Abdel Adir, with ether for everybody. Exceptionally, we can use halothane. So this was 1846 in the ether dome in Mass General Hospital. After 100 years, Harold Griffiths introduced for the first time in Canada, in Montreal, the use of curare, neuromuscular blocker. 4 years later, Cecil Gray in Liverpool developed the concept of balanced anesthesia, analgesia, hypnosis, and a degree of muscle relaxation, which we are adopting everyday practice. The spectrum increased. We have several inhalation anesthetics, several neuromuscular blocking agents. We have intravenous induction agents, mostly propofol. We have the mother component, morphine, which is still going on, and we have a lot of synthetic opioids. I will concentrate on opioids. Side effects extensively covered by Laurent. I cannot extend more than what he told us about side effects. I will concentrate on respiratory depression, the nightmare, especially in this vulnerable group. This is a closed claim analysis published in Anesthesiology about postoperative opioid-induced respiratory depression. And if you look at the risk factors, you can find here that obese patients constituted 2/3 of those who have brain damage or who died due to respiratory depression induced by postoperative opioids. So obese patients with obstructive sleep apnea are very vulnerable. What are the alternatives to the common opioids in this vulnerable group of patients? Remifentanil looks very attractive. It is a very short-acting opioid, strong opioids. It has a context sensitive half-life, the shortest one, 4 minutes. But it has at least a theoretical problem, which was pointed out in an earlier lecture by Waleed Himemi about the same topic. The sudden offset of analgesic effect may lead to hyperalgesia. And it has a solution, but this is the claim against remifentanil. Is there other alternatives, non-opioid alternatives, which can provide adequate intraoperative analgesia without the nightmare of respiratory depression? Actually, we have several potential drugs, dexmedetomidine, alpha-2 agonist. We have ketamine, mentioned also by Loran. We have intravenous lidocaine, again mentioned by Loran. We have magnesium sulfate, and we have the everyday practice, dexamethasone, which we are using as an anti-emetic. We'll explore the literature, and we'll check the evidence for the analgesic potentials of this group of medications. I'll get you the highest quality possible evidence from systematic reviews and meta-analysis. And as you know, systematic reviews and meta-analysis usually are summarized in this forest plot or odds ratio chart. This is a different studies. This is the line of no difference. And the summary comes in this diamond. We have a lot of these figures. Please look for the diamond in relation to the line of no difference. Let us start by dexmedetomidine. Alpha-2 agonist has several effects on the vessels. It is approved for sedation in ICU. This is the only approved FDA. Otherwise, all the indications are off-label. It has effects on the heart. It has effect even on the kidney. So it has multiple pharmacological effects. We are looking for the analgesic effects. This is a systematic review and meta-analysis about the possible use of dexmedetomidine intraoperatively in adult patients, not obese patients, not the population we are targeting, undergoing conventional surgery, not laparoscopic surgery. It included 18 randomized control studies. Dexmedetomidine was given to 800 patients and control group constituted of 400 patients. The findings: intraoperative opioid consumption and pain intensity in PACU were improved with the use of intraoperative dexmedetomidine. Postoperative opioid consumption, as you can see here, in favor of dexmedetomidine, less opioid consumption. Postoperative nausea and vomiting, clearly in favor of patients who received intraoperative dexmedetomidine. What about the anesthetic sparing effect? This study compared patients who received intraoperative dexmedetomidine for control with respect to sevoflurane requirement. As you can see here, patients who received dexmedetomidine have less sevoflurane, 60% reduction in sevoflurane requirement. What about the hemodynamics? As we'll see later, hemodynamic effects of laparoscopy are numerous, including hypertension, increased systemic vascular resistance. This will come in the coming slides. This small study compared fentanyl as analgesic to dexmedetomidine as analgesic for bariatric patient, for obese patients undergoing bariatric surgery, and looked for the hemodynamics. As you can see here, the blood pressure expectedly and heart rate were lower with the use of alpha-2 agonist dexmedetomidine. So based on evidence, strong evidence, mostly from systematic reviews and RCT, we can say reliably that dexmedetomidine has sedative and analgesic effect. It has anesthetic and opioid sparing effects. It is associated with less postoperative nausea and vomiting, and it has improved hemodynamic profile during laparoscopic surgery. What about ketamine? Here I am talking about a small dose of ketamine, adjuvant, not as a main anesthetic like before. Ketamine, as you all know, is N-methyl D-aspartate receptor agonist, an antagonist, and this is responsible for its potential analgesic effects. Ketamine was first described in 1956, but as you can see from this editorial published this month in the European Journal of Anesthesia, it's still going on, September 2017. With respect to the evidence, this is a systematic review and meta-analysis, huge one including 70 randomized controlled studies, approximately more, almost 5,000 patients. What were the findings? As you can see here, time to first postoperative analgesic request was in favor of patients who was longer in patients who received ketamine. The postoperative opioid consumption was in favor of patients reduced in favor of patients who received ketamine. This effect of ketamine is not very popular. Not everybody is aware about the anti-inflammatory effects of ketamine. This systematic review was published in Anesthesia and Analgesia. They looked for anti-inflammatory effect, and the surrogate or the marker was interleukin 6. They compared patients who received ketamine to those who did not receive, and they looked for interleukin 6. As you can see here, interleukin 6 was much lower as an inflammatory mediator in patients who received ketamine. So ketamine has anti-inflammatory effect, and this might help with the enhanced recovery after surgery concept. It is NMD antagonist, it is analgesic, and it has anti-inflammatory effects. Small dose of ketamine. Lidocaine, touched with Loran, it has the potential of analgesic effect, anti-inflammatory, improve the gastrointestinal motility, and it has anti-emetic effect. Let us look for the evidence. Several systematic reviews have been published. This is one of them published in the British Journal of Anesthesia, 45 RCTs, 2,800 patients. They looked for analgesia, opioid consumption, GIT motility, postoperative nausea and vomiting, and there was no difference between control group and those who received intravenous magnesium sulfate intraoperatively. What is more alarming in this systematic review, another systematic review including 20 randomized controlled studies, 8 of these 29 studies reported toxic levels of lidocaine, and this is actually alarming finding. So based on evidence, the use of intravenous lidocaine, although a bit popular, but the evidence is not very supportive, and I can say it is debatable. Magnesium sulfate, another NMDA antagonist. Systematic review and meta-analysis, they found that early postoperative pain was better in patients who received intravenous magnesium infusion. Postoperative opioids less in patients who received magnesium, and it is a vasodilator. This randomized controlled study in laparoscopic cholecystectomy compared hemodynamics, especially blood pressure, in patients receiving magnesium sulfate infusion and those who did not receive or control group. As you can see here, the blood pressure, the systolic and blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure or mean blood pressure were lower expectedly in magnesium sulfate group. NAMDA antagonist, analgesic effect, and it is vasodilator. Dexamethasone, we give it almost every day as anti-emetic. Does it have analgesic effect? A systematic review and meta-analysis published in the British Journal of Anesthesia, and this is another systematic review published in Anesthesiology, and you can see it reduces the pain scores in the early postoperative period. Even after 24 hours, the pain scores for those patients who received dexamethasone about 0.1 milligram per kilogram, 8 milligram, post-operative opioid consumption less with dexamethasone. It is an antiemetic, anti-inflammatory, as you know, and you can add it has analgesic effects. And we give it anyway for everybody. Let us come to the second triggering factor for the concept of opioid-free anesthesia, laparoscopic surgery. Most of the abdominal surgery are done now laparoscopically, and it is common sense that laparoscopy is associated with less pain. So this will make a potential for opioid-free anesthesia, and this is supported also by systematic review. The hemodynamics of laparoscopy are very peculiar. This is detailed hemodynamic changes. I will concentrate only on systemic vascular resistance, which increase by 60% and is commonly associated, if are using balanced opioid based anesthesia in laparoscopic surgery, consistently or most commonly, you will get hypertension. Bariatric surgery, obesity is increasing. The number of all bariatric surgery is increasing, so you are expected to feel, to meet every day an obese patient, probably with obstructive sleep apnea, very sensitive to opioids. Lastly, enhanced recovery after surgery, very growing concept. In their guidelines, they advised the minimization of use of opioids intra or post-operatively, or you can use non-opioid, and even they recommended that use short-acting agents, minimize opioid. This will reduce the cost hospital stay, as pointed out by Laurent. The target of opioid-free anesthesia, of course, you have to maintain adequate anesthesia. And this should be monitored by bispectral index. This is not optional, it is a must. Maintain hemodynamics, rapid recovery, and of course, reduce or eliminate the possibility of respiratory depression. Let us go for the potential active ingredients. After reviewing the literature, what is the potential active or what are the potential active ingredients? We have finished the review of literature, and it's time to hear from you. What do you think? Who are the major players? After reviewing, if I am going for non-opioid analgesic, what do you think? Let me listen from you. Choose three. I have told you about dexamethasone, ketamine, magnesium sulfate, dexamethasone, and lidocaine. Choose three. Magnesium. Number two. Dexamethasone. What else? Number three. Ketamine. Okay. These really are the major players. Dexamethasone, ketamine in low dose, and magnesium sulfate. Recipe and administration. The concept of opioid-free anesthesia was described by Jan Paul Molière from Belgium. He is working exclusively in a bariatric surgery center, and probably some of the attendees, maybe Dr. Rafat, Dr. Abdurrahman Lawkanina, they have went there and they have seen Molière doing his opioid-free anesthesia regimen. This has been modified very slightly by Adrian Sultana from Australia. I will not go into the detail of the mixture of Molière. He called it Molly Mix, based on his name. Molière mixes dexamethasone with ketamine and lidocaine in one syringe, give loading dose, and maintain according to the hemodynamic response, over simplification, in my view. Meanwhile, he gives magnesium infusion, desflurane as a short-acting inhalation, neuromuscular blocker, and he's a believer in deep neuromuscular block. Of course, he will give multimodal analgesic, non-steroidal, paracetamol, and multimodal antiemetic. Stand by, because this is, I think, very aggressive approach. He is getting beta blocker if you have tachycardia, getting vasopressors if you have hypotension. The Sultana modification, he kept magnesium sulfate standby, and I support this. Relevant publication. According to Molière, in one of his lectures, he said opioid-free anesthesia is used in almost 25 countries or 26 countries, including Egypt. I wonder if any one of the attendees is practicing opioid-free anesthesia. Okay, very good. So if you found 26 and Molière is doing thousands of cases, I went to search for the Molimix. Is there a publication control group comparing the Molimix or not? So I went to the PubMed, I put Molière, Jean-Paul or Jean-Paul Molière, and bariatric surgery. I found some publications, almost seven, none of them describing the Molimix. But I found a study in progress, just registered in the clinical trial, comparing remifentanil in one group versus another group receiving ketamine, lidocaine, and clonidine as a non-opioid analgesic regimen. This is in progress, still recruiting, but nothing about the Molimix. It is an eminence-based rather than an evidence-based medicine. I found one publication for Molière. This publication about dexamethasone use in bariatric surgery and it is a systematic review and meta-analysis, and Molière is one of the authors. But it is about dexamethasone, not about his mixture. They included 6 randomized controlled studies, preoperative dexamethasone infusion or perioperative compared to control or normal analgesics. They looked for PACU plus 24 morphine consumption, PACU pain scores, and postoperative nausea and vomiting. And they got the same finding which I have demonstrated earlier. Morphine consumption less with dexamethasone, 24-hour consumption less with dexamethasone, numeric pain score better with dexamethasone, nausea and vomiting less with dexamethasone. Let us come to the evidence-based answer. Is it a set menu for everybody, opioid-free, or in selected patients using selected drugs? What do you think? Is it a set menu or a la carte? Huh? A la carte. It is very clear answer. It is a la carte. For certain patients doing some less painful surgery using some non-opioid analgesics. Bariatric surgery is very good example. And respiratory cripple moving with his portable oxygen, they cannot tolerate respiratory depression. Laparoscopic surgery, not exclusively, may be hernia surgery in a morbidly obese with obstructive sleep apnea. Laparoscopic is only an example of less painful surgery. The analgesics, we have agreed that the major players are dexamethasone, ketamine, magnesium sulfate, and lidocaine. The literature is debatable. The take-home message, opioid-free anesthesia is doable in selected patients. There is a learning curve, and that one size does not fit all. Dexamethasone is definitely a major player. The use of Molymex needs validation with randomized controlled studies. In non-bariatric surgery, opioid-free anesthesia might not eliminate the use of opioids, but it will definitely reduce it. Opioid-free anesthesia is not logical without bispectral index and without adequate recovery of neuromuscular block in this vulnerable patient, maybe with the use of Sugammadex. I have a suggestion to end my lecture. Everybody knows the WHO ladder for analgesia. I suggest that we can have a ladder for opioid-free anesthesia. To start with, we can give all patients dexamethasone, bolus and infusion, low dose of ketamine, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, paracetamol, dexamethasone as antiemetic and as analgesic, inhalation and low concentration, and muscle relaxant according to the requirements. Then, if you have hypertension, despite all this regimen, you can add magnesium sulfate, like Sultana modification. If you still have hypertension, you can add low dose of opioid and you can cautiously dilate your patients. In the last Euroanesthesia meeting, there was a debate about opioid-free anesthesia, and Philip Blerick said, "My prediction is that opioid-free anesthesia will not replace current method of perioperative pain management on a large scale. Limit opioids? Yes. Ban opioid? No. Progress is impossible without change. And those who cannot change their minds cannot change anything. And thank you very much for your kind attention."
Thank you, Dr. Muhammad, for this very interesting lecture and for being on time.